Good day, my name is Tian Gildenhuys, and on this video I would like to discuss a very interesting but also a very important subject with you, as it is something that many Christians are being deceived regarding this, and that is Pilates. What is it all about? Where does it come from? What are the origins? And is it as innocent as people are trying to suggest in their normal lives? Because they say, but it's just exercise and it's good exercises and it's good for you. But we have to study the origin of something always, my brother and sister, because many times we don't do that little bit of research, deeper research, to understand where something comes from, and through that we are being deceived. But my brother and sister, it's always about our Lord Jesus Christ. So let us pray together first. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we want to glorify your name today. Thank you, Lord. We know the Bible says, where two or three are gathered in my name, I am in their midst. So, Lord, we know you're here where we're busy with this recording, but you will also be there where people will be watching this video, wherever they may be. And we pray that you alone will be glorified. We pray that your Holy Spirit will take me out of the way, that I will not be the one speaking, Lord, but that your Holy Spirit will speak in and through me, and that we will all be willing to listen to the soft voice of conviction of the Holy Spirit in our hearts. And thank you, Father, that you still give us the authority to say to Satan, we bind your works now. You will not steal this message from the ears of the children of God, and you will leave in Jesus' name. Lord Jesus, now we pray that you will cover us with your blood, that you will set up your angels all around every place where people will be busy with this video, and that you yourself will be a wall of fire round about us, according to Zechariah 2 verse 5. Thank you, Father, for your presence. Please take us by the hand and lead us now by your Holy Spirit. We ask it in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, all who know me know I always start with this verse in 2 Corinthians 1 verse 13, which reads, "For we write none other things unto you than what ye read or acknowledge, and I trust ye shall acknowledge even to the end." And my brother and sister, on this video, we will have to compare what the Bible says to what people are being taught in Pilates, and then we can decide for ourselves whether it is in line with the Word of God or not. Because in Matthew 22 verse 29, Jesus answered and said unto them, "Ye do err." That means you are being misled. You are deceived. Why? Not knowing the scriptures nor the power of God. And that is the problem with so many people today, even Christians. They are being misled. They are deceived. They err. Why? Because they do not know their scriptures. And why don't they know their scriptures? It's many instances, it's because they don't know the author of the scriptures. We are so busy with dead religion that we are not in a relationship with Jesus Christ himself. And only when we enter into a relationship with Jesus Christ and get baptized with his Holy Spirit, that he through his Holy Spirit gives us a hunger for his word, and then he opens the scriptures to us, and then we get to know the power of God in our personal lives, wherever we may be. But you see, when we really get to know our scriptures and get to know the power of God, we also know how to discern between what is deception and what is truth in our lives. Now let us see what the history is regarding Joseph Pilates. German-born Joseph Pilates was living in England, working as a circus performer and boxer, when he was placed in forced internment in England at the outbreak of World War I. While in the internment camp, he began to develop the floor exercises that evolved into what we now know as the Pilates mat work. And you will see at the bottom of my slides, I always give due credit to every person whose work I use in my research regarding any specific topic. As time went by, Joseph Pilates began to work with rehabilitating detainees who were suffering from diseases and injuries. It was invention born of necessity that inspired him to utilize items that were available to him, like bed springs and beer keg rings, to create resistance exercise equipment for his patients. These were the unlikely beginnings of the equipment we use today, like the reformer and the magic circle. Joseph Pilates developed his work from a strong personal experience in fitness. Unhealthy as a child, Joseph Pilates studied many kinds of self-improvement systems. Take note of the word self-improvement systems. And then the blue part. He drew from Eastern practices such as yoga and Zen Buddhism and was inspired by the ancient Greek ideal of man perfected in development of, look at this now, number one, body, number two, mind, and number three, spirit. Keep this little part in mind, that in the Greek ideal of a perfect man, you have a perfect man in body, mind, and spirit. A little later on, we'll see what the Bible says. On his way to developing the Pilates method, Joseph Pilates studied anatomy and developed himself as a bodybuilder, a wrestler, gymnast, boxer, skier, and diver. Joseph Pilates taught in New York from 1926 to 1966. During that time, he trained a number of students who not only applied his work to their own lives, but became teachers of the Pilates method themselves. This first generation of teachers who trained directly with Joseph Pilates is often referred to as the Pilates elders. Some committed themselves to passing along Joseph Pilates' work exactly as he taught it. This approach is called classical style Pilates. Other students went on to integrate what they learned with their own research in anatomy and exercise sciences. Joseph Pilates called his work contrology. He defined contrology as the comprehensive integration of body, mind, and spirit. Again, look at this now. The integration, the comprehensive integration of body, mind, and spirit. This philosophy is beautifully elucidated in his book, Return to Life Through Contrology. Suffering from asthma, rickets, and rheumatic fever, young Joseph was teased and bullied by bigger children. He even lost complete sight from his left eye at the age of 5, which was allegedly as a result of a stone wielded by one or more bullies. While many would have been crushed, Pilates took to the weights. He began to re-educate his body through bodybuilding, wrestling, yoga, gymnastics, skiing, boxing, and martial arts. Now, my brother and sister, I also have a YouTube video on Is Yoga Safe for Christians, where I give a lot of detailed information regarding the origins of yoga and whether it can be participated in by a born-again believer of Christ. And I also have a YouTube video on the problems with martial arts, what their origins are, and can we participate in that as well. His brother Frederick also took a strong interest in self-defense. By his 20s, Joseph Pilates had studied and drew inspirations from Eastern practices and Zen Buddhism, as we said before. This is just another author confirming the same thing. And these are all people that have written autobiographies or written about the history of Pilates. So they come back with exactly the same information. He also became fascinated by the ancient Greeks' version of the perfect man in the development and balance of one, body, two, mind, and three, spirit. Again, look at the order they give here. First body, then mind, then spirit. But in Jeremiah 10 verse 2, we read that God says, "Thus saith the Lord." And remember Lord in capital letters like this in the King James Version of the Bible. L-O-R-D, when you read the Hebrew, it's written Yod, Hey, Vav, Hey, because our Father's name in Hebrew is Yahweh. But thus saith Yahweh, learn not the way of the heathen. So what do we see just from these autobiographies or the histories of Joseph Pilates? He learned the way of the heathen. In his own words, contrology is not a system of haphazard exercises designed to produce only bulging muscles. It is an exercise and breathing regime that develops the body uniformly, corrects posture, restores vitality, invigorates the mind. And up to there, it all sounds so good, but look at the blue part. And elevates the spirit. So what they're saying here is these exercise methods used by Joseph Pilates teaches you exercise. It's a breathing regime that develops your body uniformly, corrects your posture, restores vitality, invigorates the mind, and elevates the spirit. In other words, what you do with your body impacts your spirit. And again, if we go back and we look at the Greek view of perfect man, what do they look at first? The body. And then secondly, the mind. And then the spirit comes. So the view is, if you look after your body, your soul will come in line and your spirit will be elevated. So what you do with your body builds up your spirit. That is the Greek view. But is that the biblical view? What does the Bible teach us? Romans 8 verse 9 to 11 says, "But ye are not in the flesh, but in the spirit, if so be that the spirit of God dwell in you. Now if any man have not the spirit of Christ, he is none of his. And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the spirit is life because of righteousness. So the spirit of God gives us life, and gives life and also invigorates our body and our soul because of the righteousness of God that we walk in. It's not the other way around, my brother and sister. It's not doing something to your body so that your spirit can be elevated. No, you do something to your spirit through the Holy Spirit of God, and that brings you in line that your body and your soul will also become what God wants it to be as His temple. Look at the blue part now. But if the spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his spirit that dwelleth in you." So what picks up your body? The spirit of God that dwells inside of you. Your body does not pick up or elevate your spirit. So you can see here it's totally contradictory to the word that which is taught by Joseph Pilates, where he got his ideas from yoga, from Zen Buddhism, and from the Greek view of perfected man in body, mind, and spirit. 1 Timothy 4 verse 7 and 8 says, "But refuse profane and old wives' fables, and exercise thyself rather unto godliness. For bodily exercise profiteth little, but godliness is profitable unto all things, having promise of the life that now is, and of that which is to come." My brother and sister, if it was true, the Greek view and the view held by Joseph Pilates, that if you exercise your body, that it can elevate your spirit, why did the true Holy Spirit of God had Paul write this, that bodily exercise profiteth little? Because if it was true that bodily exercise could elevate your spirit, surely the Holy Spirit would have had Paul write that in here as well, that bodily exercise is good for your spirit. No, he says exactly the opposite. Bodily exercise profiteth little, but godliness. You see, if you exercise yourself in godliness to live like God wants you to do in a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, being led by His Holy Spirit, then it is profitable unto all things. Having promise of the life that now is, that means you can have a good life being led by His Holy Spirit, also in the way that you manage your body, your soul, and do what God wants you to do in your personal life, and the promise of that which is to come. In other words, the promise of eternal life. That is what the Holy Spirit gives us. But if you exercise only your body, and you think that your body can elevate your spirit, you are being deceived, my brother and my sister. This author writes in an article on Is Pilates Okay? "I've had several emails asking about Pilates as a form of exercise and if it's connected to a spirituality as yoga is. Pilates gets its name from its originator and founder, German-born Joseph Pilates. It's a workout program incorporating many elements he drew from his studies into Eastern, that is yoga and Zen philosophies, and Western, that is Roman and Greek forms of physical fitness. He called his regime contrology, which he claims is the science of control, and borrowed some basics from Hinduism's yoga, which is foundational to Hinduism's religious philosophy. Now, what does the Bible tell us about philosophy? Colossians 2 verse 8 says, "Beware, beware, my brother and sister, lest any man, including Joseph Pilates or any Pilates instructor, spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit." You see, vain deceit, it's all about my body and how good I look, and it's all about me, and look at me, and I'm so old already, and look at how good my body is. But you are being deceived, because beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. The Hindu philosophies are after the tradition of men. The yoga philosophies are after the tradition of men. It's after the rudiments of the world and not after Christ. The Zen Buddhism philosophies are after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world and not after Christ. The Greek philosophies are after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world and not after Christ. My brother and sister, so beware of learning these Eastern philosophies and Greek philosophies and thinking you're doing the right thing with all these exercises you do with your body and you feel so good. But meantime, there is another spirit behind this. Joseph Pilates' worldview, borrowed from Eastern spirituality, makes his technique of particular concern to those calling themselves Christians, as it has the potential of introducing practitioners to ideas of holism, holistic thought, that is wholeness, oneness, all is one, etc., which are all New Age views, and lead them into unwittingly becoming sympathetic towards Eastern philosophy. There we are again. Yoga and other eclectic ideologies that may trip up naive Christians who are not well grounded in sound doctrine. You see, you may say, but Jan, I'm a Christian, I'm a born-again Christian, I'm doing this and it is good for me. And so that means people that might not be as strong in the faith as you will be looking at you and say, but if you can do that, I can do that. But they start doing this and then they pulled into Eastern mysticism. And then, my brother and sister, you are the one who had them stumble. While many Pilates teachers may argue they don't teach Eastern spirituality, just as many yoga teachers argue, and I also handle all that in detail on my video on Is Yoga Safe for Christians? The basic premise of both body wellness programs are part of Eastern philosophy. Any program entwining the human mind, spirit and body, or mental, spiritual and physical health, claiming they are interrelated, should raise a warning flag. The concept of body, mind, and spirit is integral to holistic ideology and not based in authentic science. The likes carry dangers of confusion and blurs biblical truth. So what does the Bible say about this? In 1 Thessalonians 5 verse 23 we read, "And the very God of peace sanctify you wholly, and I pray God your whole," look at this now, number one, spirit, and number two, soul, and number three, body, be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And we must understand one thing. In the New Testament Greek, things are always named in order of preference. What is the most important is named first. So here we see the biblical view is spirit and soul and body. So what is the most important part? Your spirit. What is the least important part? Your body. What is the Greek worldview that is used by Joseph Pilates? Body first, then your soul, then your spirit last. It is totally the opposite of what the Bible teaches, my brother and sister. And we must also see it says spirit and soul and body. The spirit and the soul is not the same thing. The soul and the body is not the same thing. They are not entwined. We have a spirit because we as humans consist of a spirit. We are spirit beings having a soul, and my soul is my will, my intellect, and my emotions, and living in a body. And this is what we must understand. And 1 Corinthians 6 verse 19 to 20 says, what? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own? Because many people say to me, but Tian, I am my own man. I am my own woman. I can decide what I want to do with my body. I'm sorry, you can't. If you call yourself a born-again, Holy Spirit-filled child of God, then you are not your own. You belong to Jesus. For ye are bought with a price. What price? His blood on the cross. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. So if you do exercises that have their origins in yoga, Hinduism, Zen Buddhism, and Greek philosophies, my brother and sister, you are not glorifying God in your body and in your spirit. And they belong to God, your body and your spirit. And you cannot say, but no, God won't mind. God won't mind if I do this. I know he's changed his mind. No, he hasn't. In Isaiah 42 verse 8, he says, I am the Lord. I am Yahweh. That is my name. And my glory will I not give to another. So God does not share his glory with Eastern spirituality, Eastern philosophies or Greek philosophies. In Isaiah 48 verse 11, he says, for mine own sake, even for mine own sake will I do it. For how should my name be polluted? And I will not give my glory unto another. And then we read in 2 Corinthians 6 verse 16 to 17. And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. As God hath said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. So if God walks in you, my brother and sister, do you think he wants to walk into an exercise and breathing regime that is built on Eastern spirituality, Eastern philosophies, and Greek philosophies? I don't think so. And Galatians 2 verse 20 says, I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. And when I asked the Lord once, Lord, what does it mean practically to say, I live no more, yet Christ lives within me? He said, Tian, it means practically my eyes are in your eyes, my mouth is in your mouth, my hands are in your hands, and my feet are in your feet. So do you think God, who lives in your body through his Holy Spirit, wants to do those exercises that originated from the side of the kingdom of darkness, my brother and sister? And remember, God is not divided against himself. In Matthew 12 verse 25, we read, and Jesus knew their thoughts and said unto them, every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation. Surely if you use the word every kingdom, you also include your own kingdom. So if Jesus said every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation, that means his kingdom is not divided against itself. And he proceeded to say, and every city or house divided against itself shall not stand. So God will not say, it is okay, my child. You know what? I'm a holy God. I'm a jealous God. I hate idolatry. I hate idolatrous practices. But it's okay. I'll allow you to go and do exercises that originated out of Eastern philosophies, Eastern spirituality, Zen Buddhism, Hinduism, and Greek philosophies. No, God is not divided against himself. And what is the further problem regarding Mr. Joseph Pilates? Now, here is an excerpt from a paper, and I just could not get the date of this paper, a photograph that was placed in America many, many years ago. But you can go and have a look at the link that I have there on that page, a newsletter from the Masonic Lodge that Joe was a member of. Because you see, Joseph Pilates was also a Freemason. And my brother and sister, if you wonder what that is all about, I also have a YouTube video on Are Freemasons Really Free that you can go and watch if you would like. Now, the part there that I just highlighted in yellow, I'm just going to quote one part, what it says there. He talked of his long years in masonry. He was raised in St. Cecile Lodge 568 on November the 19th, 1930. And last year took dual membership in Socrates Lodge 595 because he's so busy at his gym he can't take an afternoon off. And when it says in a Masonic paper that somebody was raised in a lodge, it does not mean that he was born there and got raised there. That means he was raised as at least a third degree Mason. In other words, a master Mason. So he passed at least the third degree of masonry. So he was not just an apprentice anymore. He had actually started walking out of the darkness and into the light according to their view. If you watch that video of mine, you will see what that actually means. We also see this author writing the same thing. Joe Pilates continued training until his death in 1967. He was 84 when he passed away. Before his death, Joe became a member of the Freemasons of New York, who collected most of his possessions after his death and buried him at the Ferncliff Cemetery in New York, where many other famous personalities lay to rest. That means he was a Freemason for 37 years, from 1930 until his death in 1967. Now, he is the man that taught people in that time, but whose principles are still being used to this very day, that people believe in. He originated his exercises on Eastern spirituality, Eastern philosophies, Greek philosophies, and he was a Freemason. And what do they believe? I'm just going to give you one quote that I also use on my video on Are Freemasons Really Free? Albert Pike wrote, and he was a 33rd degree Freemason, and he said the following in his book that he wrote on the Scottish Rite of Freemasonry. He said, "We," referring to the Freemasons, "worship a God, but it is the God one adores without superstition. To you, Sovereign Grand Inspectors General, we say this, that you may repeat it to the brethren of the 32nd, 31st and 30th degrees." Now, he was a 33rd degree Freemason, so only the top 4 degrees know this regarding Freemasonry. The Masonic religion. You see, and that is the problem. Masonry is not just an organization as they try to proclaim. They see themselves as a religion, and I discussed that in much detail on that video of mine on Are Freemasons Really Free that you can watch if you would like. But he proceeds to say, the Masonic religion should be by all of its initiates of the high degrees, meaning top 4, 30th to the 33rd degree, be maintained in the purity of the Luciferian doctrine. Because the top 4 degrees of the Scottish Rite of Freemasonry are also known by the name Luciferians. They worship Lucifer directly. And that means that whole system belongs to Lucifer, to which Joseph Pilates also belonged for 37 years of his life. But Albert Pike proceeds to say, if Lucifer were not God, would Adonai, that is our God, the God of heaven and earth, he says, if Lucifer were not God, would Adonai, whose deeds prove his cruelty, so he says, our God, the God of the Bible, is a cruel God because his deeds prove his cruelty, his perfidy, and his hatred of man. My Bible says God is the author of all love. He's the origin and the source of all love. God is love. But look what they say. His hatred of man, his barbarism and repulsion for science. Would Adonai and his priests calumniate him? So he says the fact that the Christians are standing up against Lucifer, against the devil, and are teaching people and warning people against the devil, that means that Lucifer is actually God. Then he says, yes, Lucifer is God. And unfortunately, Adonai is also God. Thus, the doctrine of Satanism is a heresy, and the true and philosophic religion is the belief in Lucifer, the equal of Adonai. And then he proceeds to say, but Lucifer, the God of light and God of good, is struggling for humanity against Adonai, the God of darkness and of evil. My dear, born again, Holy Spirit-filled child of God, do you think that is true? That Lucifer is also God? that he is equal to our God, the creator of heaven and earth. But that is what they believe in the Freemasonry. And that is what Joseph Pilates was a part of for 37 years of his life. Albert Pike also wrote in his book, and the book's title is Morals and Dogma, Lucifer, the Light Bearer, strange and mysterious name given to the spirit of darkness. Lucifer, the son of the morning. It is he who bears the light, and with its splendors intolerable, blinds feeble, sensual, or selfish souls. Doubt it not. Lucifer is the light, and we doubt it not. So again, Joseph Pilates was part of this. Joseph Pilates built his exercises on Zen Buddhism, on Hinduism, on yoga, on Greek philosophies. And my brother and sister, the Bible warns us in Matthew 12, verse 33, either make the tree good and his fruit good, or else make the tree, in other words, the root, corrupt, and his fruit corrupt, for the tree is known by his fruit. So people say to me, but Tian, the fruit is very good. My body changed since I did these exercises. It's going so well with me. But I also ask the question, is it also going well with you spiritually? Is it really pulling you closer to God? Or are these exercises pulling you closer to the gods of the Eastern spirituality, to the gods of Hinduism, the gods of Buddhism? Because that is the actual fruit of what you have here. And never mind the fact that he was a Freemason. And I want to end with this verse that I quoted earlier as well in 2 Corinthians 6, verse 16 and 17. And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God, as God hath said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Now, this is the part I want you to take note of in closing. Wherefore, come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. God wants us to be separate, to come out from among them. My brother and sister, I've given you some knowledge now, and I've compared what we've learned about Joseph Pilates in the history and the autobiographies with what the Word of God says. What are you going to do with the knowledge I have given you? And yes, there are other ways of exercising. There are other ways of going for a run or going climbing on a mountain, all these kind of things, without having to do these specific exercises that originated from Eastern spirituality or Greek, Western philosophies of that time. That's all about body, mind, and spirit, and integrating the three into one and all these kind of things. No, God says, come out from among them and be ye separate. We must be separate for him. And remember, it's only when you really walk in a personal, intimate relationship with Jesus Christ that he pulls you closer, teaches you more about his scriptures, and that you learn. You know what? God has never changed. He still hates idolatry and idolatrous practices, and he does not share his glory with any world view or any worldly exercises or breathing regimes. He, through his Holy Spirit, can teach you to live and exercise and have a healthy life. But we must listen to him and not to the world or the things of the world. And remember, we do not serve a dead God, because Jesus said in Revelation 1, verse 17 and 18, I am the first and the last. I am he that liveth and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. And all honor and glory goes to Jesus Christ of Nazareth. So let us pray together. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we glorify your name. Thank you, Lord, that you give us the discernment through your Holy Spirit to just compare the things of the world with your word and to see when we are being deceived. And I pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit will touch the hearts and prick the hearts of the people listening, many of your children, Lord, partaking and participating in these exercises, that they will be convicted by your Holy Spirit to come out from among them and be separate. And yes, to still look after their bodies, which are the temple of the Holy Spirit, but without having to participate in things originating in Eastern spirituality or Greek philosophies. And thank you, Father, that we know you're always true to your word, and you lead us through your Holy Spirit. And Lord Jesus, we so look forward to your coming. So we keep on crying out, Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus, for we love you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.